Good morning. Welcome to Prairie Lutheran. I'm Pastor Joel, and this is the 2nd of May, which means this year, one of my highlights, I'm a sort of sporting fanatic at all kinds of sports, but one of my favorite sports is thoroughbred horse racing. Anybody else following? Okay, got a couple. So yesterday was the 147th running of the Roses, Kentucky Derby, and it was an amazing race. Medina Spirit, no, I didn't put any money on it. But if I did, I'd put it all towards Prairie Lutheran Church, you know. But it was an amazing race. This small horse from start to finish won the race. And it was sort of that encouragement because many of us have a small faith, but when Jesus is our Medina Spirit, we're going to finish the race. Amen? So we are, as a congregation, during the year of 2020 through 2021, we are celebrating and embracing Martin Luther's small catechism. We're calling it Roots and Wings. And we're almost towards the end. We've done the Ten Commandments, we've done the Lord's Prayer, the Apostles' Creed. Now we're getting to the sacraments. Do you remember memorizing the small catechism? Yeah. One of the interesting things, Pastor Bryant and I, who attended Luther Seminary in St. Paul, as a senior, what you need to do is to sit down before a professor, and it's just like you're 12 years old all over again. You have to repeat the entire catechism by heart. Ten Commandments, Lord's Prayer, Apostles' Creed, you sort of go through that, and then you come to the Ten Commandments, the sacraments, and especially the sacrament of the altar, Holy Communion. Luther gets really verbose. He has a lot to say, so that's just fair warning. I invite you to stand as we together say the words of Holy Communion from Martin Luther's Small Catechism.
From memory, of course.
Yes.
Just kidding. You can look up there.
Martin Luther wrote the Small Catechism to explain the sacraments of Jesus. What is the sacrament of the altar? It is the true body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ under the bread and wine instituted by Christ himself for us Christians to eat and to drink. What is the benefit of such eating and drinking? The words given for you and shed for you for the forgiveness of sin show us that forgiveness of sin, life, and salvation are given to us in the sacrament through these words. Because where there is forgiveness of sin, there is also life and salvation. How can bodily eating and drinking do such great things? Eating and drinking certainly do not do it, but rather the words that are recorded, given for you and shed for you for the forgiveness of sin. These words, when accompanied by the physical eating and drinking, are the essential thing in the sacrament. And whoever believes these very words has what they declare and state, namely, forgiveness of sin. Thanks be to God. Amen. You may be seated. Our service continues with our opening song.
Feel free to join us in singing along as we celebrate a bit of learning about communion through Let Us Break Bread Together.
When I fall on my knees with my face
as you are able, I invite you to stand as together we use the words to confess our sins. Let us confess. Almighty God, you knew us before we came into existence, and you saw the very day we turned from you. We try to live for you, but continue to fail. We confess that we are in need of a Savior. We ask for your Spirit to fall fresh on us, to purify our lives. Lord, give us the grace, discipline, love, and guidance only you can provide. Forgive us of our wrongdoings and keep us upright in your eyes. Amen. Let's take a few more moments of personal confession. Amen. Brothers and sisters, I have good news to announce to you that our Lord Jesus Christ has looked upon you with his mercy and has forgiven your sin. As a called and ordained pastor of the Church of Christ, I therefore declare unto you the entire forgiveness of all your sin. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. As forgiven people, I invite you to give everyone a wave of forgiveness and greeting this morning, especially those who are viewing us from afar as we stream together. Congregation may be seated. This morning we are celebrating the sacrament of holy baptism, and I'd like to invite Paul and Mamie and little Olive and sponsors to come forward at this time. And if you'd stand right around here. Yeah. How are you doing? Good to see you again. Good to see you too. Yeah. Welcome back. It is a joy, especially to celebrate with Paul and Mamie. It wasn't so many years ago that you were standing here for your wedding, and many of your family members were in the sanctuary here celebrating the love that Jesus gave you, and now a second child, Olive, we celebrate and give thanks to God as well. Today we welcome Olive Mae McNeil into God's family through the sacrament of holy baptism. God, who is rich in mercy and love, gives us a new birth and a living hope through the sacrament of holy baptism. The power of sin is put to death in this holy flood, and we are raised with Jesus Christ to a new life. We are united with all the baptized in the one body of Christ, anointed with the gift of the Holy Spirit, and sent out in mission for the life of the world. Parents and sponsors, whom do you present for holy baptism? Amen. Parents and sponsors, in Christian love, you have presented this child for holy baptism. You should therefore faithfully bring her to the service of God's house, teach her the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, and the Ten Commandments. And as she grows in years, place in her hands this holy scripture and provide for her instruction in the Christian faith, that in living in the covenant of her baptism and in communion with the church, she may lead a godly life until the day of Jesus Christ. Parents and sponsors, do you promise to fulfill these obligations? If so, respond yes with the help of God.
Yes, with the help of God.
Amen. As we pour water that has been drawn from the Jordan River where Jesus was baptized, let us pray. At this font, Holy God, we pray that you would breathe your Spirit into this water, into all who are gathered here today. Illumine our days, enliven our bones, dry our tears, wash away the sin within us, and drown the evil around us. Satisfy all our thirst with your eternal fountain, and bring to birth the body of Christ, who lives with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. There we go. And Paul, if you want to come a little bit closer there. Olive Mae McNeil, I baptize you in the name of the, pause, Father, in the name of the Son, In the name of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I think Dad got rebaptized here with the sleeve right there. All of May, using this oil from the Garden of Gethsemane, I anoint your head with the sign of the cross and the mark of the Holy Spirit forever. Amen. And I'll give you back your adorable headband there. As Jess lights the candle, we are reminded that Jesus on the Mount of Beatitudes, he said, "Let your light so shine before others that your good works may glorify your Father who is in heaven." And let's now use these words as we welcome Olive May into the family. We welcome you into the Lord's family. We receive you as fellow members of the body of Christ, children of the same Heavenly Father, and workers with us in the kingdom of God. Amen. Let's give God a praise offering. Congratulations. You may have your seat. Yeah. Ready to go, Paul. Congratulations. We now hear the word of the Lord.
Good morning. My name is Sharon Teagues. The Lord's table is a bountiful feast that is open to all. At this table, we are fed with love, forgiveness, and grace. We receive exactly what we need so that we can move out into the world as the hands and feet of Jesus, inviting people to the feast that has no end. This morning's reading comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 6, beginning with verse 5. When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him, he said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread for these people to eat?" He asked this only to test him, for he had already had in mind what he was going to do. Philip answered him, "It would take more than a half year's wages to buy enough bread for each one to have a bite." Another of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. "Here is a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fish. But how far will they go among so many?" Jesus said, "Have the people sit down." There was plenty of grass in that place, and they sat down. About 5,000 men were there. Jesus then took the loaves, gave thanks, and distributed to those who were seated as much as they wanted. He did the same with the fish. When they had all had enough to eat, he said to his disciples, "Gather the pieces that are left over. Let nothing be wasted." So they gathered them and filled 12 baskets with the pieces of the 5 barley loaves left over by those who had eaten. Here ends the reading.
I'm so excited to see so many of you here today. I was wondering if anyone would want to come up and join me this morning to sit up on the steps. We have a really cool story to talk about this morning. It's very exciting. You just have to sit right here by me. You don't even have to sit next to me. That's fine. That's okay too. Good morning. So good to see you. You can stay in your seat too if you want. Do you want to come up and join us? You can bring your snack. Okay, that's okay. All right. Hi, you guys gonna come up? Hello. Oh, you've got your snacks. Smart. Hi, everyone. Okay, so today we're talking about a story that Sharon just read about Jesus feeding 5,000 people. Do you think there's 5,000 people here today? How many people do you think are out here today? Do you think it's 5,000? No, it's not 5,000. You would be right. There's less than 5,000 people here. 5,000, yeah, eight. It would take so long to count them all.
It's 8.
I think there might be more than 8, though. Yeah, 5,000 people is a lot of people, and all Jesus had were 2 loaves of bread and 5 fishes. Can you guys do that with your fingers? He had 2 loaves of bread and 5 fishes. And he performed a miracle so that there was enough food to feed 5,000 people. It's a miracle that so much food that came out of 2 loaves of bread and 5 fishes. And we're talking about that story today because we're talking about communion. Do you guys know what communion is, what it happens up here in church? It's where your parents, you know, they right now and with COVID, they get the little cups, and they have to try to peel back the paper, and they eat the little wafer, and then they drink a little bit of grape juice in there. And we do that to remember Jesus' sacrifice for us. And we do it together as a community to eat a meal. Do you think that little cracker and that little juice is a meal? Do you think if you ate just a little cracker and a little thing of juice, you would be full? No, probably not, right? But we do that not to eat a whole meal, but to remember what Jesus did for us all together and remember that he is always there for us and that he died on the cross to forgive our sins. And he will always love us, no matter what. All right, do you guys want to pray with me? You could fold your hands and close your eyes and everyone can repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for loving us. Help us to love you, love others, and love ourselves. Amen. All right, well, thank you so much for joining me up here, guys. You can head back to your seats.
Grace and peace from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who provides us with an abundance of forgiveness and love. Amen. I had a friend growing up that lived on a farm. Their family raised a bunch of animals, but their main focus as a family was beef cattle. Now, in small town America, it's not unusual for farm kids to bring in their animals. And I'm not talking just about the local county fair for sheep or for cattle. I'm talking our Spanish class in high school. Had a fiesta, and one of the kids was tasked with bringing in meat for that party. Their family raised elk. So naturally, they brought in some elk meat for that party. Tastes like beef. Or that friend whose family had a farm and raised beef cattle, they had a tradition where they would oftentimes name cattle after other people, family members, friends. And so one day I'm at their house, and they open up a giant chest freezer. Inside is a bunch of frozen beef. They point at it, they look at me, and they say, "That's you." Yeah, they had named a cow after me and then slaughtered that cow. I'm still not quite sure how I'm supposed to feel about that honor that they bestowed on me. But one thing is for sure, whether it's elk or pork or beef, those animals provide a livelihood for those families. When Vacation Bible School rolls around this summer in just a short few 6 weeks, the kids are going to be partnering with ELCA Good Gifts to buy a cow. A cow that provides gallons of milk a day for the family that it lives with, or allows a family to start a business and sell that extra milk, or make some cheese and butter and yogurt and sell that as well. So we don't come across cows that often here in the cities, but growing up in rural Wisconsin, they were everywhere. And it can be easy to forget how important a cow or a chicken or a pig can be for families across the world. And yet these seemingly simple creatures sustain life in abundant ways. Now that springtime is hopefully, maybe, finally here, my favorite flower is starting to bloom. And that flower would be the dandelion. I find these dandelions fascinating because while I'm trying to figure out how to kill them, my daughter is busy collecting them. She's walking around the yard, plucking them up one by one, saying that she needs to get them for mom or for grandma. She'll yell at me to come help her because there are so many dandelions out in the yard and her hands are so small that she just simply cannot hold them all. See, dandelions are omnipresent. We try to kill them, they show up anyway. We ignore them, they show up anyway. I was at the park the other day, and there's a fleet of kids running around trying to gather as many dandelions as they could. They would race to go get one, and someone else would get there first, and their faces would drop with disappointment over the fact that they didn't get that particular dandelion. Then they would just look to the right or left, and thousands of dandelions were surrounding them, and off they would go get to grab some of those. See, dandelions remind me of a small, insignificant detail in our reading today. Let's read that together again and see if we can spot it. It comes from John 6, verse 10 this morning. Let's read this together. Jesus said, "Have the people sit down." There was plenty of grass in that place, and they sat down. There was plenty of grass. That's a strange detail when you think about it. I mean, the feeding of the 5,000 is told in the other three Gospels, and that little footnote about abundance of grass, well, it's not mentioned. So why does it show up here in John's Gospel? Why do we need to know that there was plenty of grass? Let's go back one more. On hearing Jesus ask where the disciples are going to buy enough bread for thousands of people, one of the disciples, Philip, think small and says it would cost over a year's wage just to feed everyone one single bite of bread per person. One single bite. That's all that Philip can fathom. I mean, there's probably 10,000 or so hungry people there in total. And Jesus presents the disciples with a problem. Feed the hungry people. And Philip can only dream small. A single bite for each person, to him, is just simply unthinkable. But that's not eventually what happens. Those thousands of people are fed not with just one single bite. I mean, this isn't an appetizer round or a bunch of snacks that get handed out. This is a meal. We're told the people are fed with however much they need. Again, Philip can only think about how problematic it's going to be to feed everyone one single bite of bread. And then there's Jesus. Jesus says, "Let's feed them until they're full." Let's feed them until they're full. I mean, it's no wonder that in John's telling of this event, Jesus himself does the feeding. Jesus looks out at the hunger in front of him and doesn't settle for sample-sized portions of bread and fish. The people are going to eat until they're satisfied. And even then, there's still going to be plenty of leftovers to go around. Because this event, the feeding of the 5,000, it really isn't about the bread and the fish. That detail about the grass really isn't about the grass. The dandelions aren't about the dandelions. They are all about abundance. I don't know about you, but when you look outside, there are plenty of dandelions to go around. There was plenty of grass for the people to sit on, and there is enough food for the people to eat until they are full. There is enough. If you could this morning, raise your hand if you have ever loved someone or something. Ever loved someone or something? Yeah, most folks here. So my first love was a fat, fluffy cat named Sassy. She was the only pet that my family had growing up, so it was easy to love that chunk of fluff with, you know, all my middle school self could. But fast forward to now, there's a few things in my household that I love. My wife, another cat, there's two dogs, and now there's two kids as well. So let's think about how love works. When I married my wife, it was just the two of us. Then we added a cat. Now, we didn't look at this emotion of love and figure out how it had to be divided up between one another and this cat. I could say that I love my wife and that cat, and out of nowhere, there was just more love to go around. And then two dogs came along. It's the same exact story. We didn't have to reduce the amount of love that we had for each other and the cats to now fit in these two dogs. There was just more love. And then two kids show up. Each time we didn't have to treat love like it was a commodity that was scarce or finite. There was just more of it. There was always enough. We know it's only, I got 9:43 in the morning here. I'm going to ask you to do some math with me this morning, if that's okay. I know it's early, so if we fall behind a little bit, I'll have a summary at the end. But in mathematics, there is a concept of different sizes of infinities. Hopefully I haven't lost you quite yet. Different sizes of infinities. So imagine this, if you will, this morning. Imagine a hotel with an infinite number of rooms that's completely filled. It's completely full. Okay, so hotel, infinite number of rooms, it's completely full. Okay, so a bus then shows up to this hotel, has an infinite number of passengers, and they're all looking for a room in that hotel that's completely full. Oh, and you're the manager of this hotel as well. Hotel, infinite number of rooms, bus shows up, infinite number of people, they all want a room in this infinite hotel that is completely full. So what are we going to do with the little problem we have in front of us here this morning? There's a few things that we could do to get that infinite number of people on the bus into a hotel that is completely full. One of the simplest things that you could do, someone's crying because they don't want to do math this early in the morning. I'm sorry, I know. You can move that infinite number of guests you have into even-numbered rooms in your hotel because there's an infinite number of even-numbered rooms. And once you've done that, you've freed up all the odd-numbered rooms in the hotel. And there's an infinite number of odd-numbered rooms. So the bus with an infinite number of people can suddenly fit into a hotel that was completely filled. You're not sleeping yet? No, okay. In short, there is always room. There are always enough dandelions. There's always enough grass for the people to sit on. There's always enough bread and fish to eat. Because at the end of the day, it's not about the amazing number of people that were fed that day, but how the people were fed. Abundantly. At the end of the day, communion isn't just about the bread and the wine. It's about Jesus. It's about Jesus showing up with forgiveness and love and not showing up with just small morsels of either of those. Each and every time, Jesus is providing you with exactly what you need. So I'm going to leave you with a challenge here this morning. Whenever you come across a dandelion outside, and I know they're starting to sprout up absolutely everywhere. So on your way home this morning, when you see that dandelion, I challenge you to think about abundance. To think about abundance, and not just a plant that the world is going to call and label a weed. Or when you see a cow, or a chicken, or a pig, think about the families whose livelihoods come from those animals. Or whenever you taste bread and wine, think of forgiveness and love, so much forgiveness and love that your heart bursts. And whenever you think of Jesus, whenever you think of Jesus, think abundance. Because there is space for you at this table. There is plenty of space, plenty of forgiveness, and plenty of love. Because with Jesus, there is always enough. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Good and loving God, we give you thanks that you satisfy our hunger. You provide us with an abundance of forgiveness and faith and hope and love. You provide us with exactly what we need each and every day. Help sustain us and fill us so that we can move out into your world, proclaiming and giving others that same forgiveness and grace and love that comes through you. And it's in your name that we pray. Amen.
Thank you, band, for singing that wonderful Elizabethan, all that hath breath, doth come before the Lord. So I love that. Love the melody, too. So we are going to transition now into our mission moment, which we celebrate each week. And for that, I would like to have Matt Lesnikowski come before us. Thank you, Matt.
You can tell Pastor Joel knows his flock. Pastor Brian gets quantum theory, and I get multiple choice. For those of you who I haven't met, my name is Matt Lesnikowski, and my family and I have been members of Prairie Lutheran Church for over 15 years. My wife, Tracy, and I raised our family here, and in fact, Pastor Joel's going to marry our oldest, our daughter, this summer. So thank you for that. This month, we're kicking off our annual stewardship campaign. And this spring, we're focusing on St. Paul's conversation from 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7. God loves the cheerful giver. This is something I've experienced in my life as a follower of Jesus. While I grew up thinking that giving was something that was expected of me, I've come to understand that there's a lot more that is gratifying in making giving a priority in my life. And I've learned so much from PLC around that. This is a generous, generous community filled with cheerful givers. So this morning we put together a quiz to show you how over the last challenging 12 months, 14 months, we're getting there. How over these past 12 months, even in the challenging times that we've had, we faithfully practiced our habit of holy habit of giving. And I have five examples from this past year. So I'm going to give you four options, and you get to guess which option is the correct answer. Okay, and so what I'm going to do is ask you when you see the question, we'll read it off. You raise your hand for the right answer, and we'll check the answer, see how we do. Fair enough? Okay, so first question. The pounds of food donated to Prop in 2020. How many think it's A? How many think it's B? How about C? There's a few, okay. How about D? A little bit more. So you all study the whole, if you don't know the right answer, it's C for multiple choice, right? I did too. Let's see the answer. It is C, 3,727. Nice. Second question. Phone calls made by staff during the pandemic to PLC members. Is it A? How many think A? Got a few for A. How about B? Got a few for B. C? Who likes D for an answer? There's a couple C's, D, a couple D's. Let's see what the answer is. A. Boy, we've got a smart congregation, don't we? Generous and smart. Let's go to our third question. How many dollars given in benevolence from 2019-2020? How many think the answer is A? How about B? How about C? A couple C's. How about D? Okay, let's see the answer. Wow. You know, I have to say, pretty sharp congregation. Fifth and last is the number of, number four, the number of pints of blood donated during the pandemic in this past year. A? Couple? How about B? Quite a few more. C? How about D? And let's check the answer. A, okay. Got a little surprise on that one, but good news. We get an opportunity to give even more coming up. And finally, the last question, question number five, fifth and last, the number of sandwiches made and donated to 363 Ministries. How about A? Who likes A? Couple for A. Okay, how about B? B, got some B's. C's, not too many C's. How about D? D's, quite a few D's. Okay, it's a toss-up, let's see. D, 1,308 sandwiches, that is fantastic. So as you can see, PLC is a congregation that walks the talk. We've been richly blessed, and we cheerfully give. And this month, you'll be receiving mailings and some information on how you can continue the good work that God's begun at PLC. You have the opportunity to cheerfully give to the mission and ministry of PLC as we go forward. And I want to give you an example of how you can step up in faith and step up in your giving. So this step chart that captures all of the households of PLC gives you a sense of, you know, number of people over time, how much they've given at different times. And what I'd ask you to do is just take a moment, take a look at the chart, and see with your mind's eye where you are. And then I'd ask you to please try to take that step of faith. One more step up. See what it does for you and see what you can do for others. We have a bright future together because Jesus is leading us to new ventures. I love this place. I love this congregation and I love the people in it. Many of you in this room are family, some of them even very close family. And I know you do as well. So take some time to take a look and see where you fit, but see where you want to go from there. We all have room to grow. Thank you for your time. And have a good Sunday.
Matt, thank you very much. You know, Aaron Rodgers has been in the news a lot lately because of the NFL draft. Yes, this is sort of a sports Sunday, and he may no longer have a job because he was so good on Jeopardy. But if he stays with the Green Bay Packers, Matt, I think you've got a job with Jeopardy in your future as well. Thanks again. As you're able, I invite you to stand as we offer the prayers of the church. Let us pray. With joy we sing and praise your name, O Lord, this morning. And today, this is a day that you have made that we may rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you for making all living things and knitting us together in your creation. Let all who have breath praise your holy name. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the words and the witness of the sacrament of communion. You feed us with forgiveness, even when we don't deserve it. You quench our thirst, even when we have questions. Thank you for your goodness and abundance. Help us continue your meal of mercy in all we do and say. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy Spirit, with healing in your wings, we turn to you and lift up these names for your tender care. Cheryl Shaw, sister of Bonnie Morin and Connie Pries. And hear now these names that we speak in the quiet of our souls. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, there are many in your world who are hurting. In Israel and their loss of life last week, and for India and the thousands who are now dying from the pandemic there, bring aid and comfort and strengthen those who help. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, O Lord, we offer these prayers and petitions, trusting in the strong name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated for the announcements. I'd like to invite Jess to come forward.
Good morning. What a wonderful Sunday. Thank you all for being here and joining us. It's been just full of excitement and fun and math for some reason. I would like to talk to you about that, Bryant. I don't think that needs to happen on Sunday morning this early, but let's get started with our announcement. So first announcement, we have a May We Pray calendar that you can find a copy on plcchurch.org, or you can find a printed copy out in the narthex. Just a way to spend some time thoughtfully praying throughout the month of May. You can pray by yourself or with your family, and it's posted on all of our social media sites as well. So check that out. All right, and then next, we have VBS. The VBS this year, I'm very excited. We're getting into it. We're not gonna think about how close it is, but it's gonna be so much fun. We're doing God's Good Creation VBS. It's all going to be outside. The curriculum is through ELCA World Hunger. So we're going to be talking a lot about hunger, like Brian mentioned this morning. So the kids will be raising money to buy a cow through ELCA Good Gifts to talk about hunger globally. But then we'll also be raising, collecting different boxes of food for PROP to help with their summer food initiative. So that's something really exciting. The deadline for signing up to get a free t-shirt is May 14th, so everyone wants a t-shirt, so you gotta sign up by then. So you can find that online. Let's see, next, also along with that, if you want to support VBS in any way, we have an Amazon wish list that will be up on our website very shortly, but I think the link also went out in the post this week. So just a way to help us gather some craft supplies, some game supplies, and stuff for snacks as well. All the fun things, pipe cleaners, construction paper, whatever. So if you want to support the children's ministry in that way, we really appreciate it. Great. And then PLC Youth is going to summer festival camp this year, which is going to be really fun. It's at Gustavus Adolphus. There's a middle school week and a high school week. You can sign up or contact Caroline if you have more questions. And then lastly, just a little blurb, we have our midweek community meetings happening now. The weather looks like it's finally cooperating with us, so we're really excited. So if you are a kid and you want to come to club, that's happening on Wednesday. Caroline is also hosting Ultimate Game Night for the youth. I don't know what game they will be playing this Wednesday, but last Wednesday we all played Capture the Rubber Chicken instead of Capture the Flag, and it was a phenomenal time. So come join us for that. And then Pastor Bryant also has a Bible study. So that's all happening on Wednesday. So thank you very much. I invite you to all stand for the benediction.
You know, Pastor Joel, I thought I'd get out of here without thinking about Aaron Rodgers this morning, so thank you for reminding me of that. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and with mercy. And the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.